Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Aaron Sheldrick, and I work for Reuters. Nearly 5 years after the Fukushima nuclear disaster, the fallout from the catastrophe, continues to impact Japan's energy situation. To date, utilities have only managed to restart one nuclear reactor, despite strong government support for rebooting the sector. And a significant ramp-up of units is likely to be fraught and time-consuming. Takuya Hattori is a senior advisor of the Japan Atomic Industrial Forum and served as president of the industry body between 2007 and 2015. Prior to joining JAIF, Mr. Hattori served as executive vice president at Tokyo Electric Power Company, the operator of the destroyed Fukushima nuclear plant. He has 36 years of experience in nuclear power generation at TEPCO, a company much maligned for its response to the disaster. He has kindly agreed to come and talk to us about the future of nuclear power in Japan and how it is a necessary part of Japan's energy mix. He will give a brief presentation and I'll open the floor up to questions afterwards. Before I hand over to Hattori-san, please make sure you've turned off all your mobile devices and please show your appreciation to our speaker. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Alan. A very kind introduction. My name is Hattori. And before starting my presentation, I would like to confirm the distributed materials. The first is a handout of the copy. And next is JAIF Bloch. This is our organization. And the third is the very detailed the Japan for the nuclear power station for the database. And today I would like to the title of my presentation is Energy Situation and the Role of Nuclear Power in Japan. And the contents of the today's talk is as shown here. And I prepared too much for the material and I will skip the. And next is the introduction of JAIF, Japan Atomic Industrial Forum. This established in 1956. The non-profit and private organization and membership in the 450 organization. And the chairman of our organization is Takashi Imai. You might well know, the honorary chairman of Japan Business Federation. Our mission is to promote peaceful development and utilization of nuclear energy. And activities now we are focusing three pillars. One is public acceptance, the second, international cooperation, and human resource development. All of these are the current issue of the Japanese nuclear industry. And also I would like to talk about the JICC, the JAIF International Cooperation Center. This was established 2009. The mission is cooperation for newcomer countries. They're supporting so many countries now, they are planning to start for the nuclear program. And we, Japan, as a developed country, the nuclear developed country, we are fully supporting their program. The main activity is the human resource development and the establishment of the relevant laws and regulation and public acceptance, and also the preparation of necessary infrastructure. And next, I would like to talk about the Fukushima accident. There are so many areas. This is a very few, only the key issue. Still, 100,000 local people have been suffered as evacuees and preventing measures of the contaminated water leakage. This might be the main risk of the current Fukushima Daiichi. And the contaminated water has been purified and stored in the storage tanks. Almost 600,000 tons of such a huge amount of the water is stored. Mostly the clean up and purified, but it's very difficult to discharge this water. We need for more talk with the fishermen union. This is a very political issue. The third, next is the decommissioning of the damaged reactors has been deployed based on the mid and long-term roadmap. This was the joint activity with the government, but the so-called how to access to the debris, the core, the melted core debris, that is the most difficult issue. We don't know about where these debris is located and what's the configuration, and no information we have not yet get. And we are now trying to using the robot how to access, how to take out, and where should be stored and final disposal. There's so many issues we have. And also the decontamination of the surrounding environment is in progress. And two municipalities have already lifted up their evacuation order. But the people who are coming back to their hometown is a very limited number, about 10 or 20% of such number, mainly because for the infrastructure is not yet coming back. For example, for the hospital, the school, and the shopping. And so this, it's, I think it's not so optimistic for the, even though the decontamination work the deployed, it's not so easy. What's the lesson learned of the Fukushima accident? And back to the Three Mile Island accident and the Chernobyl accident, we learned the human factor and safety culture. In the case of the Fukushima accident, we learned about the safety myth. We had recently the IAEA, the Fukushima report issued. In that report, the safety myth may be that is one of the reasons. And also we lack of imagination. We have to imagine more, even though it's a very low possibility. We have to learn. We have to imagine, but we do not have such kind of the imagination. And also after the accident, emergency preparedness is not well prepared for that. And I think that you well know about this safety enhancement after Fukushima. This is the schematic view, and one of the most famous for the sea wall. You can see the sea wall. In the case of that Hamaoka Nuclear Power Station, that was a tube electric power company, that sea wall, the total length of sea wall is 1.5 kilometers, and height is 22 meters, huge concrete structure to protect for the tsunami. But no one knows the higher than 22 meters, such kind of tsunami may come, but it's maybe it's a very low possibility. But they prepare, the tube electric company prepare, even though the so high, such a huge tsunami come to the attack to the building, the building for the doors were watertight, and the necessary equipment was the laid up to the for example for the electric vehicles and fire engines and so they can overcome for such a situation. And what's the impacts of the accident? This is my personal opinion. The most serious impact is my view is loss of public confidence on nuclear power. And also we have to reassess the nuclear safety and also the public fear on radiation exposure. This is also very big impact for, especially for the local people. And also the reassessment of the nuclear policy and energy policy. And next is I would like to talk about the energy situation of Japan. I think you well know about that. You know this Japan is located in Northeast Asia, where it's a geopolitically important region, close to Korea, China, and Russia. And mild weather, sometimes severe typhoon and flood, located high seismicity and volcanic region. And next might be the most important, it's no indigenous natural resource, energy resources. Energy self-sufficiency is around 6% without nuclear. This figure is very low compared with other OECD countries. And small island country and mostly mountainous and isolated country. This is also very important. Isolated country means no electricity grid, no pipeline network with neighboring countries. Why not? Maybe this is a very good question, but now we have no grid, no pipeline. And in the future, we will have, but we need for more discussion. And lastly, the densely populated and 127 million people and highly industrialized country. And GDP is $5 trillion US dollar per year. That is a few number three of in the world. This is the energy situation in Japan. It's a historical trend of electricity consumption. You can see the how much we consume. The terawatt hour is around 1,000 terawatt hour we consume in a year. And the kilowatt hour per capita is around 8,000. This is not so a high value. Maybe this is about half of the United States or other countries. And this is the energy policy, the prioritization of the energy policy. Looking back in the past, in 1950s, reconstruction after World War II, and the 1960s, securing the energy supply, that is, Japanese economy's sharply increase. And so the conversion of the fuel, the hydro to coal and oil. From 1970, the diversification of energy sources is a very important issue, especially after oil crisis, oil to gas, nuclear, and coal. And also the energy conservation is also deployed. From 1990s, the reduction of the greenhouse gas emission is one of the big issues for the international issue. You know, this UNFCCC, that was 1994. And from 2000, we reach the mature country, and the energy consumption is not so increased from the time. And at that time, it's for the Japanese government decided for the basic energy law 2002, and pursuing the 3E and liberalization of electricity market study. And Fukushima accident happened. And from that time, it's pursuing S plus safety plus 3E and electricity system reform. Now, this is in the process. And last year, the fourth strategic energy plan was decided by the cabinet. I would like to talk about that afterwards. This is the energy situation of Japan is compared from the 1955. As I mentioned, in 1955, the mainly we depend on the hydropower, and the red portion is the coal, and the very few is oil. At that time, it's major the energy source is coal and hydro. And 1965, the oil portion is increased, and in 1973, this is just before the oil crisis. The 73.2% is depend on the oil, too much oil dependent. And 79 and 85, that we pursuing the energy mix, best energy mix. And finally, with the right hand side, you can see 2010, the nuclear is 28.76, and next is gas 29, and coal 25, and coal in the 7.5, and hydro is 9.7. Compared with other countries, please look on the left hand side is Japan's 2010, and look at the EU, the right hand side. Very similar the configuration, the EU and Japan is very similar. The other countries like United States is very much depend on the coal, and China is mostly 80% depend on coal. This is a typical daily energy demand change. This in Japan is demand is very much changeful. And the peak demand will happen in the summertime around 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And the base load is nuclear power and hydro and coal and LNG and oil and pumping power. This using these combination of the energy source, we supply, we secure the supply of the energy. This is a nuclear history of the nuclear development in Japan. Is the starting is 1953 Atoms of Peace, and Japan's officially started the nuclear program in 1955 Atomic Energy Basic Act of Japan is enacted, and AEC studied and JERI studied in 1956, and JAIF also, our organization studied 1956, and. 2010, we have the 54 units, 30 BWR and 24 PWRs, and total capacity is 49 gigawatt. And now it's 43 units and 42 gigawatt. This is a nuclear development program. There's a prioritization of nuclear development. There are from 1955, the mainly for the preparation for introduction of the nuclear power. And from 1970, this deployment of the nuclear power is the first generation of light water reactor studied operation. And until 1985, we established the indigenous technology, promote localization and improvement of standardization program that was supported by the government, and development of the advanced light water reactor. And from 1985, this is my view, 1985, this promotion of recycle policy. Until that time, we are mainly focusing for the construction of the nuclear power plant. And after that, we change it for the main target to the for the recycle or the back-end site. This is a development history of the nuclear power, mainly in the improvement on the standardization program. The lower portion you can see the phase one and phase two and the phase three we have fully supported by the government, and we develop our indigenous technology. When we started the first generation nuclear power plants, we encountered so many troubles. I myself, my history, my experience mainly how to tackle, how to resolve the so many troubles, not so big trouble, mainly for the weldment, for the pipe, for so many, many troubles. And based on this, the feedback of this experience, we established more reliable, the more cost-effective and technology. I will talk afterwards. This is the history of the Japan nuclear development. White and black, and you cannot see it. But anyways, this is you can see it in Japan. This we from 1960, we are continuously construction of the nuclear power plant. We never. The interrupt with these until 2010 was the timing, and the length of the bar chart is the construction time. The length is relatively very short compared with other countries, especially in the compared with United States in the early 80s war. And it's very, very short term construction time. This is the energy policy. You well know about that. The basic principle of the Japanese energy policy is simultaneous achievement of 3E, and pursuing the best mix, And after Fukushima is S+3E, the safety on the premise of safety. 3E on the premise of safety. And also for the nuclear, securing 3S, this is also very important. Safety, safeguards, and security is a basic principle. This is the energy policy of the energy mix. The before that is the fourth strategic energy plan of Japan was decided, and the position of the nuclear power is important baseload power source, and restart nuclear power plants after safety assessment by NRA. This is very easy to understand, but next statement is very confused and very politically decided. Dependency on nuclear power will be lowered in the future. And finally, the energy mix was decided this July. And you can see the right-hand side in 2030s, the nuclear power the around 20 to 22%, and the renewable 20 to 24%, and the rest is the thermal power, 56.6%. And CO2 emission was decreased, lowered, compared with 2013. This is also the very politically decided the difference year. And the 26% decrease compared with 2013. 2013 is no nuclear power operation. And so very big amount of the CO2 was emitted. But compared with that is very politically decided. And next is restarting. You might be interested in this area. You know there's 43 nuclear power plant, and construction is, this officially under construction is 3 nuclear power plants, all ABWR, and 14 units were shut down for decommissioning. And this year, this August, the Sendai number 1 restarted. But at present time, how many units and when can restart is unknown. This is official comment on me. Next is the current status of nuclear power plant. I think you well know about that. I will skip. And the what's the effects of the shutdown of the nuclear power plant? This is also well known. Power supply, and many times I would ask from the overseas countries, the how do you assure the energy supply? Then my answer is the restarting aged fossil plant. This is my question. The next question is, why so many aged fossil plant you keep? this is a very good question. But the utility company has about 20 or 25% the surplus for the energy supply capability. But these are very, very unreliable and very high risk for considering for the stable energy supply. And biggest impact is additional cost is 3.37 trillion Japanese yen. This is about this $100 million per day. It's a huge amount. The CO2 emission increased about 10%, and the electricity rate changed about 25% for household and 40% for industry. This is the history of the Sendai. I think you will know about that. If you have any question after that, I will answer. This might be that you are very interested in that. And the right-hand side, you can see the Sendai 1 has already started. And next is the Sendai 2. The last weeks, the Kyushu Electric Power Company officially announced they will start for the Sendai 2 next week. And the Sendai 2 will be the next step. And the next is the Takahama 3 and 4 and the Ikata 3. These are, and also the Genkai 3 and 4 and the Oi 3 and 4 and the Tomari. These and the red or pink colored, these are PWR. And left hand side is the Kashiwada Kariwa. This is a top runner of the BWR. And Onagawa 2, Hamaoka 4 and the Shimane 3, Shimane 2. And white colored, that is the very, very just started for the assessment process. It takes more time. This is my view in the 2030s. Maybe it's, is it possible, feasible to supply 20 or 22% of the by nuclear? This, my view, is if some of the unit can extend the operation time, operation period, we can supply 20 or 22%. This figure shows this left-hand side, the red bar chart, is we have now the 42 gigawatt, and out of 42 gigawatt, the 43 units out of 42 gigawatt, 23 gigawatt, 25 units reached 40 years when 2030. And conservatively, we have to shut down all these units. This is the yellow bar chart show this means. And we have to start from the 19 gigawatt, 18 units. And plus some of the unit, the extent, the orange colored, is extension X gigawatt alpha unit. And now under construction, 3 unit, 4 gigawatt green portion. And finally, the blue one is 19 plus X plus 4 gigawatt. And we have to, this value should be the in between for the 28.6 to 31.4, around 30. And so X should be 7. X should be 7. That 7 units, 7 is around 7 units, such number. This might be feasible. That's my view. And this is one of the assumptions. This the total power demand is 1,000 terawatt hour in 2030, and the nuclear generation capacity factor is 80%. Based on these assumptions, the X should be 7, and 7 or 10 or such numbers. This is also the very important factor, the current, looking at the current and the energy policy or the nuclear policy. In these 2 years, we are following the opinion poll, the different mass media. Left-hand side, you can see this was based on the Asahi, Nikkei, Yomiuri, and NHK. And these data is in these 2 years is no change. The question is, do you support nuclear power plants restart after NRA approval? On this question, about 55 to 60% people is against, and about 30 to 35% is support. And the difference between two is about 20%. This is a big difference. And so we have to consider this situation. The current Abe administration is carefully looking at this data. This is my view. And how about the nuclear? We are, I talked until now, it is mostly in Japanese situation. But I would like to talk about how about it in the world. Now we have about 443 units and 396 gigawatt, and we are operating 30 countries. It's a very limited number. Out of these, the United States, France, Japan, Russia, Korea, China, India, Canada, UK, and Ukraine, and Sweden, and Germany. These are big for the developed countries. Out of these, Sweden and Germany is now in this, they decided to phase out from nuclear. And we have almost 70 units under construction, mainly in China. And we have the planning units, and many shutdown for decommissioning is about 150 units. And generated power by nuclear is about 11%, not so big. In the world, average, 11%. And this is current operational reactors age. You can see the peak is age is 30 or 31 years old. It's almost 30 years. This is the average, the operating year is almost 30 years. How about in the future? Now we can see now it's at 394 gigawatt in 2014, and looking in the future, 2030 and 2040. And we have three scenario. Now this is the green one, is the current policy scenario. This is the current policy, and the new policy scenario is a little bit considering for the global warming, the little bit for the changing, the shifting from more green power introduced. And 2 degrees C scenario, this is to cope with the greenhouse gas emission, to cope with the current, to changing the current trends, we have to challenge this target. The COP21 is based on this scenario, but it's not so easy to construct for these huge amount of the nuclear power plant. And maybe the new policy scenario may be the more practical there. And the looking at this figure, and from 2014 to 2040, about 150 gigawatt will retired, and the new construction is 380. When the 380 divided by in these 25 years, we have to construct every year about 20 units or such huge units we have to construct. Is it feasible or not? That is the question. This is the graph of the new policy scenarios. You can see, as I mentioned, the yellow is the nuclear. The 12% is depend on nuclear, and 2040s, the still not so high the nuclear portion, but nuclear will steadily increase the capacity, but mostly increase for the renewables and coal and gas. And next question is, how can we develop the nuclear power in the, from now on in the from the future? There are many issues. The first is the nuclear safety, how to assure the nuclear safety. And next is the radioactive waste disposal. This is also very big. And also the proliferation and security risk. And the financial risk is also a big issue, especially for the newcomer countries, how to assure the finance. And also the human resource development, I am very concerned about that, especially in China. Now they are constructing 26 units. Can they prepare for the well-trained the human resources with safety culture? It's not so easy, based on my experience. And also, finally, without public support, we cannot develop nuclear power. This is also very, very important. This is very much related to the challenges, especially radioactive waste disposal and nuclear safety. And from now on, I will skip I would like to talk about the Japan technology. This is the strength of Japan technology. The next point is second point, maybe the biggest Japanese strength. Project management capability of the on time, on budget. This might be most important to keep the current, the financial, the challenge. And the nuclear industry, also the Japan's way, this is also very unique. The safety first, quality first, this is very important. And test before use, this is also very important. And project management, and the modular construction method and teamwork. And you well know about the Toyota ways, the 5S, workplace methodology of organization, Seiri, Seiton's, Seisor, these kind of very, very unique Japanese approach. And finally, I'd like to talk about the international cooperation, as I mentioned, for the JICC, JIC. We are fully supported by the government and supported for the newcomer countries. I myself several times going abroad, and I talked to the Japanese for the history and the Japanese way of business. And when the Fukushima accident happened, at that time I was on the plane, just coming back from Jordan. And I cannot landing at Narita. I landing at Kansai Airport. And next day, I coming back to Tokyo. This is one of the important area of the human resource development. We Japan with human resources development network. We started this framework for the 2010, and fully supported for the young people for the education and training, with the cooperation with international organization like IAEA. And this network, we are now the 71 the membership. All the, you know, most of the universities and the research institute and the government supported. And before closing, for the, I'd like to talk about for the nuclear, the role of nuclear to combat global warming. As I mentioned, the world energy demand increase would be inevitable. For sustainable future of the planet, we have to challenge to realize a low carbon society. The next three messages are very important. Nuclear power is mature and available today, and nuclear power is large scale, stable, and reliable. This is very different from the renewables. And nuclear power has played an important role for energy supply assurance and the reduction of CO2 emission within marginal costs. This is also very important. And finally, there is no silver bullet to realize low carbon society, but there would be no solution without nuclear. And as a closing, Japan's commitment to nuclear. Japan will utilize nuclear power as an important baseload power and keep nuclear technology to combat global warming and share the lesson learned from Fukushima accident and enhance safety of nuclear installation in the world and promote decommissioning of the damaged reactors of Fukushima in cooperation with international community. And support the nuclear development program of newcomer countries and contribute to assure the international regime of the non-proliferation and nuclear security. And we will take the lead in the international research and development program of innovative nuclear technology. Thank you for your attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Hattori-san, for a very comprehensive overview of Japan's nuclear situation. We'll take question and answers now. We can take them in Japanese because we have our esteemed interpreter, Takamatsu-san, on standby. So I will open the floor. I will open the floor to questions. First of all, from the working press, one question per person and no speeches, please. Thank you.
My name is Crowell. I'm with Nuclear Intelligence Weekly in New York. There are three nuclear plants under construction supposedly here in Japan, but it's difficult to get information about them. The Chugoku Electric Power Company is very unforthcoming with any information about Kaminosaki number 3 plant, which supposedly was nearly complete 4 years ago. And if you could also tell me how far along the Ōma plant is, and if there's any active construction really going on with the Higashidōri number 1 with TEPCO, which just started, and we don't hear very much about any of these three plants. So if you could enlarge on it, I'd appreciate it.
Thank you for your question. Based on my understanding for the Shimane 3, this is the ABWR, the Shimane 3. Kaminosaki is not yet started for construction. That is on the planning phase. Shimane is Chugoku Electric Power Company. This is marked on the ABWRs and on that for the slide. And the Shimane is mostly finished, about 95% finished. That was official figure. I don't know if it's 95, 97, I don't know. But a lot, more than 95, I think, my understanding. And the Ōma is around 40% finished. And the Higashidōri of the TEPCO, Tokyo Electric Power Company, is less than 10% or so. Yeah, I think so. This, but not yet for the actual the construction work. They are the holding for current situation. The TEPCO's case is very compared with other the Ōma and TEPCO is holding with them, but they do not decided for the stop for the construction. They are now keeping for, and I think this. As I mentioned, for the current for the NRAs for the assessment, Ōma has even though these are under construction, they have already submit for the assessment report, but their construction the schedule is announced for the 2021. That is the current schedule. And the Shimane 3 is not yet submit the assessment report. I don't know how the Chugoku Electric Power Company are thinking about that. But anyway, mostly finished, and also the ABWR. And from the viewpoint of the technical viewpoint, this is very safe and very reliable. And soon they will submit their assessment report, and reach the construction, reach the final stage. But I don't know their schedule, their planning. And next for the very important point is in the case of the Ōma. Ōma is, you know, this so-called full MOX plant. They consume the plutonium. The plutonium stockpile is one of the big issues in the Japanese for the nuclear community. How to consume the current accumulated plutonium. And Ōma is a full MOX. When they reach the full core by MOX field, they can consume about 1.1 tons per year or such number. But they started the small portion of the MOX and so. After reaching the full MOX, they can consume. But anyway, how to consume the plutonium, that is a big issue. From the viewpoint of the non-proliferation and also the relationship between the United States and the United States, Japan and the United States cooperation agreement that will come for the 2018 for the limit for the 2018. That is the time for the two revise or two. Japan and the United States, the cooperation agreement. We have to reach the conclusion between Japan and the United States. And so the schedule of the Ōma construction, very, very important to that, from that viewpoint.
Hattori-san, thank you very much. My name is Neil Newman from GAFCAL in Hong Kong. I just wanted to just follow on from what you're saying about consuming plutonium. In the UK, of course, we have the same plutonium issue, and we have our own nuclear disaster that's still being cleaned up. And I read that Hitachi GE have been promoting PRISM nuclear reactor, which is some new technology that consumes plutonium, shuts down in the event of an emergency. I was just wondering if there has there been any similar marketing in Japan, and is there possibly a future for that here? Thank you.
Yes, and for the future research and development, that is also a very important activity. Many ideas coming out. Not only is the PRISM, but other for the IFR and the high temperature gas cooled reactor. That is also very, very good. The reactor to consume the much for plutonium. But that is in the future. We can say when. But for the plutonium issue, is the next or the next 5 years or next 10 years. Considering that time frame, we cannot depend on such a future reactor. We have to how to consume. At present time, it's only the way by the MOX in the light water reactor. You know, in Japan, and before the accident, we are planning to have the 16 to 18 the reactors and consume for the plutonium that was generated by the locational reprocessing plant, and also we have so much stockpiled in the UK and France. But at present time, that's such kind of planning is very difficult. And so I'm not sure how the government and the utility companies at present time. I myself have my idea, but too sensitive one. Yeah, and so I cannot say today. But anyway, how to consume the plutonium. We, the Japanese the nuclear communities, very concerned about that. That is only I can say. Sorry.
Thank you.
Tom, and then you.
Thomas Sullivan, Matthias Energy, Hattori-san, thank you very much for your presentation. I wanted to ask you about, I understand the public prosecutors in Fukushima Prefecture have decided to pursue a case of negligence against TEPCO and officials at TEPCO. I was just wondering if you could comment on that. Do you think they have a case against your ex-colleagues in TEPCO?
So I think what you're referring to is an incident that was reported last week. It seems to be that immediately after the accident, this has to do with contaminated water being released into the sea, and there seems to have been a whistleblower that made an appeal to the Fukushima Prefecture officials and said that the contaminated water was not adequately treated before it was released. In other words, there was a management negligence that was brought to light. And as far as I know, Fukushima Prefecture officials took officially the complaint, but they have not moved any further than just simply accepting the complaint or appeal. And as there is no further information available to me right at this point, it's hard for me to make any further comments.
Hi, my name is Steven Stepchinski. I'm a reporter with Bloomberg News. Thank you very much for your presentation. I thought it was really nice. You mentioned that the IAEA report on how Japan had the lack of imagination when looking at potential problems and safety risks. Do you think that the NRA has fixed that problem and that the current safety procedure that they're going through and the tests that they have take into account this imagination problem? And I also have a second question. How important, in your mind, do you think restarts are for the 10 regional power companies? Are they something that will be very important for their financial status going forward? Thank you.
The first question is about for the menu, the safety culture, I think. I think with current NRA is for the basic for the most important aspect for the current new regulation is based on the importance of the safety culture. And so the current for the new regulation was based on these for the understanding for. And so that this is already reflected to the new regulation. And so, from now on, that is not a matter of the NRA regulation, but the matter of the utility companies itself, management level, not only to the management level, but the actual worker level. That is not on the matter of the not only for the utility company, but all the nuclear related the employees have to have to think about for the more the how to improve the continuous improvement work. Such kind of mind most important, and questioning attitude. Even though the worker level, the daily life, they have to not just follow the order to feedback to the very small matter, we have to have the questioning attitude. You know the very famous story for the O-ring or that was broken in the Challenger. That was one of the engineers well know about that, and he proposed to stop for the test for the rocket for the to stop, but such kind of information is not reached to the top management. Such kind of we have to learn such kind of experience, and so I think this Japanese utility companies well know about that, well understand, and now in the process of the changing their mind. And the second question is the utility company. As I mentioned on this slide, for the very big impact, but the cost to generate power, compared with thermal power with nuclear power, maybe more than 10 yen per kilowatt hour, such level. Very huge amount of money we have to import all the necessary for the fuel by gas, and now gas is the gas price is decreasing, but still Japan's premium, so-called Japan premium, the Asian premium, said this is the very high compared with the cost of the current cost in the United States, and compared with also with European country, it's the very high cost for the gas. And so how to reduce these costs is one of the very important task for. And so, you know, this movement for the TEPCO and the Chubu, and jointly they have new companies for to buy the gas for them. And so there's a very, very big impact for. And so the Kyushu Electric Power Company, they have already started, they very much improve their current for economical status situation.
Excuse me. So, my name is Hanjo, and I have two questions. First of all, in regard to nuclear waste, it's said that even breeder reactors, fast breeder reactors, produce nuclear waste, and this nuclear waste takes several thousand or several tens of thousands of years become harmless. In other words, human beings are going to have to manage this nuclear waste for tens of thousands of years. But when we look back at human history, civilization goes only back to about 5,000 years. So is it really realistically possible for human beings to be able to manage this waste for tens of thousands of years? And the second question is in regard to page 10 of your slide. The data ends at the year 2010. Can you tell us what the situation is after 2012? So I'd like to begin with the second question because it's a little bit easier to explain. First of all, the reason I stopped at 2010 is that afterwards it was very difficult for me to find good data to use as comparisons. I was looking at UN data previously up to the year 2010, but I really could not find appropriate data that would accurately reflect the situation. In other words, that I could make a good comparison with Japan. I think that if I spent a little bit more time, I would be able to find better data and present better a chart like this, but I can say just in general terms that the GDP data probably will not change very much. I think it will basically stop at around $5 trillion US dollars. And if you divide that by the population of that time, you can get to the right-hand column number, which is the kilowatt hour per capita. And I think, in other words, that this 8,378 is not going to change very much, and that 1,000 terawatt is also not going to change very much as well. I said that I believe that the 1,000 terawatt hour figure will not change very much, even going up to 2030. There have, I should point out, been some government estimates that say 1,065 terawatt hours. But when we talk about something as far distant in the future as 2030, I think these smaller differences are not going to make that much of a difference. The reason for this is that there's so many variables that could change. For example, what will the structure of Japanese industry be? What exactly will the population be of Japan? And B, we know that the population of Japan is decreasing by about 250,000 people per year. So what will be the electricity dependence? What will be the final electricity makeup? That is all pretty much going to change. But I believe that 1,000 terawatt figure, and then that kilowatt hour capita being somewhere around 8,000, that's not going to change so much. So thank you very much for your first question, which is actually very, very difficult, but it's a very important question. In regard to nuclear waste or the radiation toxicity of the processed fuel, this is, of course, a huge problem. Uranium exists in the natural world, and but the toxicity of that uranium is much, much lower than the nuclear waste that has been produced by nuclear power plants. And in order to raise the radiation levels of the used fuel to natural uranium radiation levels, it will take, as you have pointed out, several tens of thousands of years. Some people are saying even 100,000 years. We're talking about spent fuel that has already been processed to some extent, fuel that has been transformed in shape into glass particles. And certainly, in regard to this, several tens of thousands of years, going up to 100,000 years, researchers throughout the world are trying to develop technologies to shorten that time. And one way to deal with this potential problem is to use fast breeder reactors. Of course, until now, in the past, fast breeder reactors were thought of as a way to produce energy effectively using spent fuel. However, the way that fast breeder reactors are being looked at now is slightly different throughout the world. It is thought to be a way that we can shorten that time in which the spent fuel can be made less toxic quicker. The point is that there are great expectations held by many for researchers throughout the world as to how much they can shorten the time for to bring down toxicity levels or radiation levels to natural uranium radiation levels. Some people are optimistic and saying maybe 8,000 years. Some people are very, very optimistic and saying even several hundreds of years. But in any event, for the time being at least, we are talking about time on the scale of thousands or tens of thousands of years. And certainly I understand what you're saying is that something, given the shortness, the brevity of human history in the past, is that something truly possible for human beings to do in the future? So for now, the answer, the provisional answer that is being given by people throughout the world is to bury it. Of course, process and the fuel as much as possible, but then to bury it very, very deep underground. And although you mentioned the idea of human beings being able to, humankind basically managing this spent fuel for tens of thousands of years, by burying it, what we're really doing is transferring the management to the Earth, to the planet. In other words, basically asking the planet to take over this responsibility, because human beings may not be able to. At the same time, however, there is also being given great consideration the possibility of ensuring that even though that field is buried, that there will always be some option to retake it out of the earth, because in the future it might be that technology advances and that fuel will be able to be taken out of the earth and reprocessed and made harmless or very quickly. Or if there is some kind of an accident, some kind of an emergency situation, again, to be able to have the option of being able to take it out of the earth is going to be very, very important. So in a sense, because this is not only a question for scientists, it becomes a societal problem, it becomes a global problem. The biggest question facing us today is how can we prevent harm from coming to future generations? It is not something that people have come to an agreement about. This burying this fuel in the earth is one option, the only option that we're seeing right away, but it is not the only option, and there isn't final consensus not only in Japan, but throughout the world. Yeah, it is a topic of a great debate.
I take a question from this gentleman over here, and then this gentleman at the back, and then you.
Thank you, Mr. Hattori. My name is Patrick Walter. I'm with Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung, German Daily. I have a question. Can you give us any number how much the decommissioning and the cleanup of the Fukushima accident, what are the costs? Who is paying for these costs? Is it TEPCO, or how much is given by the government or the taxpayer? And after Fukushima, are there any preparations in other utilities to prepare for a situation like that in order to shoulder costs like that maybe in future times?
Thank you. The cost for the decommissioning of Fukushima Daiichi, you know, this three damage core that was Fukushima Daiichi 1, 2, 3. And number 4 is heavily damaged for the building itself. And so the cost of the, and also the unit 5 and 6, the Fukushima Daiichi 5 and 6 is not damaged, but there's, the surrounded area is heavily contaminated. And not so easy for the two for decommissioning of these reactors, especially in the case of the unit 1, 2, 3, and 4. And the cost of these decommissioning is the paid by TEPCO, the current for, based on the current for the current decision. And the TEPCO has already the estimating for the how much for it takes for the order of the trillion yen, the total. Yeah, I don't know the how much for that. And other reactors, other normal, the normal of the decommissioning fee, that is already the each utility company has accumulated for the as a fund for the decommissioning fee. That is proportional to the generated power. That was based on the law they accumulated. And the total, the cost of the decommissioning is roughly speaking about is, for example, for the 1,000 the megawatt hours class such kind of reactors is 60 billion Japanese yen or such number. But I think this that cost is estimated in the more than 10 years ago, and so should be the revised for the related cost. But anyway, for the that is not so high, and also these the work is not so difficult compared with the Fukushima Daiichi case. The mainly for the not so much for the newly developed. The area we have to improve is how efficiently the decommission and how to reduce the radiation exposure for the worker, how to introduce for the robot for the how to perform the more efficiently. And next for the issue is how to treat the generated radioactive waste that was in the process of the decommissioning. At present time, this Japan's regulation is not well prepared for that, and now in the process of the new regulation for the how to treat decommissioning waste, the waste of the, that was generated by the decommissioning process. Is that answer your question?
Can you talk about the costs of the cleanup of the Fukushima area?
The cleanup is that is very much related to the regulation, and so this how, and also the cleanup that was the nuclear power station, that territory is, I don't know this, also, I don't know the exact for the number, but the order of the trillion yen order. And so, totally for the 10 trillion yen for the decommissioning and the cleanup order. My understanding is such order. No, I'm not sure.
Koji Igarashi, freelance journalist. Following question, quick question, previous but one, okay? Let me speak in Japanese.
So I'm a freelancer, and I'd like to ask about the nuclear waste question, which was mentioned a few questions ago. You said that the only feasible answer, the only possibility that is being considered seriously at present is to bury this nuclear waste very deep into the earth. Therefore, it's going to be for several hundreds of years or several thousands of years or even up to 100,000 years. In any way, it's going to be a very, very long time. So my question is, do you think in the foreseeable future that we will be able to find a place within Japan or perhaps outside of Japan where this nuclear waste can truly be buried? And if so, where might that place be? Thank you very much. It's a difficult question, so I'd like to answer Japanese. First of all, the government, as you know, is trying to do research and try to identify several sites within Japan that might be a final disposal site for this nuclear waste. And I believe that as a result of their efforts, not too far in the future, there will be an official announcement by the government that will announce several possibilities for disposal sites. And it will not just be one or two possibilities, but many sites that, from a technical point of view, could be considered appropriate or adequate places for this nuclear waste to be buried. I think whether it will be over 10, whether it will be several tens of sites, I'm not quite sure, but it will not be as small as one or two possible sites. So I think, as I mentioned earlier, the government is in the process of doing research and trying to build a case for explaining why these sites are appropriate sites. But at the same time, as you all know, this is a very, very politically sensitive issue, and many different considerations must be taken into account so that when the announcement comes, so because of these political considerations and the fact that different political sensitivities must be taken into account, probably when the government announcement comes in the very near future, they will not be very specific announcements as to specific cities, etc., but probably just general regions and the probable general number of sites that can be considered as possible burial sites. But in regard to this problem, as I mentioned earlier, this is not just simply a technical issue. It is an issue that involves all of society, and therefore, when we consider the significance of this problem, I think we need more debate within all of society. Certainly, the idea of trying to find a place within Japan, we need first of all consensus that eventually, because we did produce this waste, we do need to somehow dispose of it, and we need to take responsibility for it, and the idea would therefore be that the consensus would be in Japan that we would try to find a place for it within Japan. And you mentioned earlier the possibility of finding a place outside of Japan. This is also a possibility that has been repeatedly raised in the past, and certainly for very justifiable reasons. The fact that Japan archipelago lies in a volcanic region of the earth, perhaps Japan, anywhere in Japan, is not the best place on earth to bury such waste. But at the same time, Japan is a signatory to various international treaties, and in regard to the disposal or management of nuclear waste, fundamentally, according to international treaties and international understanding, it is considered the responsibility of the country producing the nuclear waste to basically take care of that nuclear waste. So although I'm not dismissing the possibility that eventually this nuclear waste that Japan produces could be buried somewhere else in the world. At present, I think that is too simple an answer. And although various countries in the past have been named, for example, Antarctica, Siberia, some emerging nations where it seems that there will not be much development in the future, of course, whenever such problems, which names are raised, there's always opposition voices raised as well. And it's only natural because we have to first deal with this issue as a society and come to a final decision first. At the same time, we see what is happening in other nations of the world. EU is composed of maybe 28 countries, and of that, those 28 countries or so, about half of them, about 14, actually use nuclear power plants. To expect that only the 14 countries take responsibility for that nuclear waste and bury it on their territories is perhaps not necessarily the best answer. After all, you do have this larger organization, the EU. It might be that, although there are countries within the EU that don't actually produce any nuclear waste, they would be more appropriate for disposing, acting as final disposal sites for the nuclear waste. In other words, there are debates going on on the international stage as well, and we should take note of those international discussions as we debate what to do within our own nation.
My name is Kurt Sieber. I'm an associate member. Thank you very much for your presentation. I'd like to come back for a moment to the Ōma plant. And a few months ago, I don't remember how many months ago, we had the mayor of Hakodate City here to make a presentation about Hakodate City filing a lawsuit against the Ōma plant because Hakodate City is within the 30-kilometer range from the location of the plant. At the same time, there are also legal hurdles with other plants, just as an example, Takahama, for instance. District courts in different prefectures are making quite different judgments based on, certainly facts, but also the feeling of the inhabitants in the area. So my question to you is, to what extent do you think that these legal hurdles as a whole will have an influence on the energy mix in the sense to what extent can the percentage 20 to 22% in the government plan can that be influenced by legal hurdles? Thank you.
Thank you for your excellent question. I think it gets to the heart of the matter. I think it is a very excellent question indeed. I think that when we look at the restarting of the nuclear power plants process, there are several elements that come into play. One is whether the new regulations, et cetera, that have been put into place by the Nuclear Regulatory Authority are being reflected in the operation plans of the nuclear plants. That is one question that is being addressed, but one thing that is not truly been addressed enough is the fact that the evacuation zone around nuclear power plants have been increased after the Fukushima accident from 10 kilometers to 30 kilometers. And that means that there are many, many more other municipalities, prefectures, et cetera, residential areas that are being affected. And this problem has not truly been addressed. And yet, in spite of that, the government and nuclear power plant, electric utility companies are going forward with trying to get the plants restarted, and that I think is the heart of the problems that we are seeing today. That's at least my personal opinion. You've pointed out specific examples about the Ōma plant and the Takahama plants. The Takahama plants, not only do they have problems with the courts, that there are several lawsuits that are in place that are being that are progressing, but not only that, they have not been able to successfully get the full-out support of local governments, whether they are municipalities or prefectural governments in the area. And in spite of the fact, again, in spite of the fact that they have not been able to get this kind of support, in spite of the fact that they have not been able to address all of the concerns that residents have about proper evacuation emergency procedures, still the government is moving forward with trying to restart these plants. And I think that is very, very problematic indeed. And yes, as you have pointed out, I have not taken into account all of these difficulties that each plant or reactor is having with its local residential groups in giving this figure of 20 to 22%. Whether that's achievable or not really needs to be looked at in more detail, taking all of these factors into account. I believe that it all depends on how successful one is in being able to convince local residents that enough safety precautions have been taken, that there are preventive emergency measures put into place. And it also means that the national government must show its commitment in a credible way it must show that, in a way that's believable, that it is prepared to take on responsibility and action for something that if something occurs. And I think the government still has not yet done that and is simply moving forward with the restarting. And that's what's causing these problems. I'm sorry that my my comments are very, very vague, but I personally share with you these concerns.
Okay, well, we're out of time, so thank you very much for a very comprehensive presentation and attempting to answer all the questions. There's one thing left for me to do. We normally give our speakers 1 year's honorary membership, but Hattori-san is a member of the FCCJ, so we will give him
a bottle of wine.
Thank you for your
thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Very nice.
I appreciate it.
Thank you.